It's time for the Shantae Speculation Trilogy to become a saga. What's up, guys? Alpha Stoutland here, and welcome back to the final little snippet of Shantae evidence we've got for her in Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. I was gonna stop with the third one, but as soon as I said that, and as soon as people started saying in the comments, well, you missed this, I was like, I gotta do a part four now. So I certainly don't mind doing it. It's just, you know, I don't want this to be all my channel is about, but I mean, I'm gonna ride the hype train with you guys as long as I can. I do still think Shantae has a chance. I'm not gonna lie, the haters are starting to wear on me, but then at the same time, I look back at these videos, I'm like, why do I worry? Like, there's so much going for her. And I know I say that in every single video, but it's kind of just reiterating it to myself so I don't lose hope in her, but also because I need something Smash-related to talk about because I'm dying. We haven't gotten anything since Isabelle and anything huge since King K. Rool. And like, I love Isabelle and she's great, but nothing compares to the hype that Ridley and King K. Rool brought. And I'm starved for that. But yeah, before I make this video intro too much longer than it usually is, I do want to shout out two people in particular. One is my dude, Papa Gino's. I say my dude, but we just met in the podcast, but he's just such a cool dude. I've followed him on YouTube for several months now, ever since he started really doing Smash leaks and speculation and stuff. He's just a really cool, down-to-earth guy, really chill, really cool, and I really enjoy his content. And he stopped by the channel and left well wishes for Shantae and Smash. That was cool. If you aren't aware, my friend Drew and I actually did our GG Gaming podcast episode 22 with him. I'll provide a link for that in the description. Go check that out. Papa provided a lot of cool insight on not just Shantae, but just Smash in general. Shared some of his most wanted picks. Like I said, he's just a cool dude. He was a great guy to talk to. And Papa, definitely always cool to see you around the channel, man, and keep up the good work. And something that really excited me when I first saw it was that Artsy Omni left a comment on my channel. And if you are not aware of who Artsy Omni is, he is the Saiyan-haired wonder guy who is behind Smashified. They started this back in like 2015 with the Smash Ballot. They did renders for Banjo-Kazooie, Shantae, Shovel Knight, Rayman. He's the guy who did that big Rayman leak. He's just a talented dude, and just for him to stop by my channel was so cool to see. Of course, he did kind of damper my spirits on Shantae a little bit, not gonna lie. But of all the people who have provided counterpoints to Shantae and Smash, I feel like his is the most grounded. Because it's not about, oh, she's too sexy, oh, she's an indie character. It's WayForward could just be doing this to build hype and just, you know, benefit from this financially and stuff. So he provides some really good counterpoints. And so I would recommend go to the comment section of the last Shantae video and go check out his comments thread, because he provides a lot of good counterpoints to what I was saying in the video and what I've been saying in the video. So, Omni, thank you so much for stopping by, dude. It was a pleasure to have you, and just, it was cool to get to talk to you. Someone that you look up to on YouTube and have enjoyed their content for years. It was cool to see you stop by, man, so hope to see you around soon. There's also a couple things I needed to clear up from the last episode that I either got wrong or misquoted or otherwise, and the first thing I want to clear up is that there actually is not a Nintendo Switch Joy-Con themed costume for Shantae in Half Genie Hero. That's actually just an advertisement that WayForward did to advertise her getting onto the Switch. I thought there was actually a costume in-game, but as far as I've been able to tell, there is not, and so I apologize for that misinformation. That was all my bad. I should have done more research. I also want to say that the way I worded it about Shovel Knight being an assist trophy and kind of, it sounded like I meant that because Shovel Knight's an assist trophy, Shantae is going to be in the game as a playable character, and I didn't mean it like that. I just meant that because Shovel Knight's now been deconfirmed as playable, that makes Shantae's chances better. It also could mean she's an assist trophy alongside him, which I pray not, but I do think it gives her a better chance of being playable, and we'll talk about that more in depth because there's someone who left a really cool comment in the comments that I will be reading out a lot of comments today, by the way, so we'll talk about that more in a little bit. And I completely retract the K. Rool and Ridley thing about them being evil pirates and Risky Boots being an evil pirate and stuff, and I should not have put that in the video. That was all me. Looking back, it's just like, dude, why did you put that? That's so stupid. But yeah, guys, I'm the scapegoat on that. You know, just send me off into the wilderness, so. And one thing that really bummed me out this week, and after I got so hyped for it, was that there was a Shantae image leak that I had seen a while back, and I was just like, eh, whatever. But then this leaker guy came out and said that there was a leak, a real leak, that had ruffled Nintendo's feathers. And I immediately pegged this Shantae render image as the leak that he was talking about. And it turns out it is fake. It's a really well done render, but someone on Twitter pointed out to me that it is very blurry, and the text for Shantae's name under new fighter does not match the text for Isabelle and other fighters. So yeah, I'm bummed about that. I can't deny this is a really good render of her. Of course, it's just kind of traced over a Charagumon figure, but again, it's really cool, and it's cool that someone took the time to do this for Shantae. And so that just gives me more hope, because again, it shows the impact she's had on the Smash community and the fan base that she has. So that just builds my hope up even more, even if it is just a fake leak. So now that I've cleared up the last episode and given my shoutouts to Papa and Omni, it's time to finally wrap this up, guys. This is the final Shantae Smash speculation video I've got for you guys. So, let's do it. If you'll recall, in the last video I did, I actually talked about two of Christina V's tweets. One where she talked about being wrapped on a game, and the second one where she talked about her IMDb page. Well, wouldn't you know it, October 10th, right before I got my video uploaded, and I didn't even notice it on Twitter until I finished the video, she uploaded again, this time with a very blatant reference to Shantae. She posted with the caption, "Anyone wish for a half genie?" And there she is, with a Shantae dancing 8-bit render and a ponytail. Now, obviously, this isn't normally anything huge, because it's like, hey guys, I look like Shantae, look at my new hair. But you look at the September tweet she did, and you look how short her hair is compared to the October 10th tweet, and it really makes you wonder, girl, how'd you grow your hair that fast? Now, there's no way in less than a month she grew her hair out that long. Now, I have two theories about this post. One is that these are just hair extensions that Christina got, and we're just reading too much into it. But the second theory I have is that she posted this September 13th picture, but it wasn't from September. It was from several months back when her hair was shorter and she was recording for said game. This would explain why her hair is so much shorter than it is now, and it would explain a lot if she is actually being Shantae in Smash, because it would give her plenty of time to record her lines for the story mode, for her reveal trailer, for her demo play, for whatever, so ShotKar can go ahead and show her off in the game. And because I want to give you guys a little bit of credit, a big shout out to Nosferatu Ghibli and Jamie Wild for bringing this post to my attention, because I actually did not know about it until you guys said something. And another shout out to Jamie, and I know this is reaching, guys. I know it's like too good to be true, but Christina's dress looks like the Smash logo. Like, I know I'm crazy. I know I'm reading into it. I'm just gonna end the video now. I'm sorry. I've let you all down. I know. I'm done. Just kidding. I'm back. I know it's reaching. I know it's like literally as far as you can reach and just grasping at a handful of straws. But you cannot deny that it looks like the logo. It's black and it has the middle part out just like the Smash ball, and it's got the middle thing like, I know it sounds so stupid because it's not like Christina went to the dress store and was like, I need a dress that looks like the Smash ball so I can hit Shantae and Smash Bros. I know it's reaching, but guys, what if it turned out to be true? Now we're stepping away from the October 10th tweet back to the I'm wrapped on this game tweet, because GBA Boy and Nathan Dunn had some very insightful things to say about it. On a side note, Christina V is also the voice of Edelgard from Fire Emblem Three Houses and Tatiana from Fire Emblem Echoes, Shadows of Valentia, and could be recording lines for either one's appearance in Smash. I wouldn't mind this if Shantae's in this as well. But it's the secrecy and vagueness that makes you wonder, We know about those roles, so if it were for either of those games, why not throw that in with the hashtags or such, or weapon emojis for Fire Emblem instead of two flexing biceps? I mean, it could be literally for anything, but the fact that she didn't specify makes it seem that it's for a game that we don't know about her involvement in just yet. Also, depending on how far away Three Houses is from being finished, her likeliness of being done with her work on it is dubious. Like, maybe if the game was going to release first quarter of 2019, then yeah, they might be done with voice actors by now, but if it's a spring, summer, or fall release, that means there's a lot more time for more lip-syncing to be done, with cutscenes not being finished, or rewrites of the script needing new lines recorded. Both of you make excellent points, and I really do think Nathan made a really great point here, in that we know about her being in Fire Emblem. I mean, I didn't. I just learned about this through these comments. But she would have used a weapon, like a sword or something, as an emoji instead of a fist, because you don't really brawl in Fire Emblem. Plus, the vagueness, like he said, really does point to her being on like a secret project that we don't really know about yet. I mean, if it was for a fighting game or something, I feel like if it's something like Brawlhalla or Rivals of Aether, she would be able to like do a little bit more. But as secretive as it is, it kind of just points to her being in Smash. And both Manny said 7 and Ayanami 8 commented on Christina V's IMDb tweet. They make a good point that this could be a very cheeky reference to when she was accidentally added as Shantae's voice actress on the IMDb page for Smash Wii U during the time of the Smash Ballot and Smash 4 DLC. WayForward tweeted out on October 21st about Shantae's mini costumes, and now of course this is an obvious tie-in to Halloween being just around the corner, but it also could be a subtle hint to her alternate costumes in Smash. I'm just being stupid. Like, I don't... That's such a reach, but hey. And to continue with this tweet, Leaky Pandy, a somewhat credible leaker, actually retweeted WayForward's post. Now, Leaky Pandy is only somewhat credible, and whether they were just doing this as a Shantae fan is to be seen, but they could also be doing it because their sources say Shantae's playable in Smash. I know that's kind of stretching. Again, a lot of this is just conjecture and speculation, but it is interesting to note nonetheless. And as many of you have noticed in the past week and a half, Zelda's new victory pose with her little lick of fire on her finger and her hand on her hip looks almost exactly like Shantae's portrait in Risky's Revenge. The similarities only point more towards the theory I talked about last time that Zelda's being used as a base for Shantae in Ultimate, and again, only time will tell with that, but it's stuff like this that makes me even more certain that's the case. Now, my subscriber and viewer Chris Glass also left a comment about the Nindies Direct and some very interesting points about it. I'm not the one who originally stated this, but you might remember how the Nindies Direct in August ended with one last announcement, only for it to be a pretty unexceptional game. Well, the creators of the blog theory found out that the posts on the blog are numbered, and posts 120 and 121, both around the same time as the Nindies Direct, had been skipped over. So it's possible that last announcement was originally planned for a Shantae reveal, but was ultimately removed and replaced with that random game, so a Smash announcement wouldn't take away attention from the indie games. Very interesting note, Chris, and the fact that it's two posts, which could be her reveal trailer and her synopsis trailer, it makes me so much more hopeful that that's actually the case. Toy the Gamer noticed on Twitter that Alucard's assist trophy transforms into animals, just like the Sable Prince did in Smash 4. Now, if Shantae was going to be an assist trophy, I would think that she would transform into animals. And if Alucard is replacing Sable Prince, then that gives Shantae a better likelihood that she's not an assist trophy, because Sakurai doesn't really like to have assist trophies do the exact same thing. We have had some in the past before, like I think Skull Kid flipped the stage, and I know Palkia does with Spatial Rend. But at the same time, Skull Kid's still missing as an assist trophy, and his inverted controls effect is now performed by the Ramblin' Evil Mushroom. So it's very interesting to note, to say the least, that Alucard does transform just like Shantae does, and he's an assist trophy, so hey, that just gives us more hope that she's playable. Now, before we get into this next huge chunk of information, a big shout out to my dude Rob, aka I'm Canon, for DMing me all this information on Twitter. He has been so helpful throughout all this Shantae hype speculation, providing insight and providing, you know, hints and teases and stuff to me. So he provided a lot of information for this video. So, and he's just been like a really consistent supporter and commenter, even on my non-Shantae stuff. So dude, thank you for that. And it's really cool not just have you as a subscriber and someone who helped me do research, but as a friend too. So thank you, dude. And Rob pointed out that there are a lot of Japanese game developers and artists that have either played Shantae or done fan art of her. Takahito Harada, lead artist of the Disgaea series, did artwork of Shantae in his own personal style. Ko Takauchi, a character designer for the WarioWare and Rhythm Heaven series, did his own rendition of Shantae in his style. Pokemon's own Ken Sugimori played the English version of Pirate's Curse back in October 2014, before it was ported to Japan. And apparently he liked it so much, he now follows WayForward on Twitter. And the creator of The Legend of Zelda himself, Eiji Aonuma, received or bought a copy of Half-Genie Hero Ultimate Edition. Rob also mentioned Makoto Yobi from the Mega Man series, and if I'm not mistaken, he was brought on to help with Pirate's Curse and Half-Genie Hero as, like, a developer. And I mean, some of these guys are close to Sakurai, so, I mean, hey, they could suggest Shantae for Smash. I mean, hey, Ken Sugimori's apparently really close to him, so it could happen. And that has tied into characters' favor before, as we've seen with Kojima and Snake, and Nomura and Cloud. As I talked about in my other Shantae videos, the chairs and pillow behind Sakurai in the August 8th Direct could hint towards Shantae. Well, Kevin noted in the comments that both chairs and pillows are of Eastern origin, specifically Egyptian, but the fact is it's still from the East, which is where Shantae is from. I know it's reaching again, but it is interesting to note. And Zephyr Pictures noted that not only are we getting an indie assist trophy in Shovel Knight, but we're also getting indie music with Noisy Notebook from Snipper Clips. And if you also look back at Smash 4 with the Commander Video Trophy that we had in that game, we've got a trophy, an assist trophy, and music all in Smash already representing indies. The only thing we could use now is a playable fighter. As I've already mentioned, I did a podcast with Drew and Papa Gino's, and a young spirit actually left a really cool comment there that I wanted to talk about. With the level of respect some of the employees of WayForward have for Nintendo, I would be very surprised if they tried pushing them around through their fans. Matt Bozon actually said that Nintendo did know pretty well that they were fanboys and wanted Shantae and Smash, so that they didn't need to remind them in their weekly calls. It should be in the Retronauts podcast if I'm not mistaken. In fact, I am tempted to believe that they could impose on themselves some exclusivity as a token of recognition instead of being under contract. James Montagna in particular is considering himself as Sakurai's disciple. He shared the picture of Sakurai giving him a thumbs up following their exchange on Kirby as a motivational, as well as a selfie with him. He also has pictures and autographs from Miyamoto and Iwata he got when he was very young. He calls him Sakurai-san in the indie representation in Smash podcast with Source Gaming. I love that point that Young made, that WayForward could actually have imposed an exclusivity contract on themselves to not have Shantae in any fighting games except Smash, not because they had to, because they wanted to, because they look up to Nintendo that much and Nintendo has looked out for them this much all these years, and this was a way for them to say thank you while also being added to Smash. And that honestly sounds like something that WayForward would do, as big of fans as Nintendo as they are. Now, Jamie Wilde noted something really interesting, and that is King K. Rool doesn't have his pirate ship as a stage, and if I might add on to that, they added Gangplank Gallium's remix without Gangplank Gallium. Now, this of course could reference Shantae, as Risky's pirate ship would pretty much be her stage if she was added, as it's where she moved her slumber party to. However, MyY100 does make the good point that we already do have a pirate ship stage from Wind Waker for Toon Link, but I feel like with Wind Waker's pirate ship being so small, I feel like Risky's could be very different and unique and have like Tinker Bats and Risky shooting at you, and it could just be this bigger pirate ship that would be totally different from the one that Toon Link has. So I feel like they could both have unique pirate ships. It's just, would they? I guess time will tell. As I said in my last Shantae video, WayForward, James Montagna, or Matt Bozon haven't mentioned anything about Shovel Knight and Smash yet, but they congratulated Yacht Club Games several times since 2015 on Twitter about their various achievements. And it's weird because though they haven't mentioned Shovel Knight, James has talked about King K. Rool getting into Smash. It's very weird to see, especially when you see how supportive WayForward has been towards Yacht Club Games in the past, and how they haven't really said anything this time around. Now this next part, I do want to say that Super Mario Bros. Brought it to my attention on YouTube, but when I was going through Smashwords, because I just made an account on there, so check me out. Someone with the screen name Moderately Obsessed actually said that they came up with this idea first, but yeah, I'm giving you full credit, Moderately, so thank you guys for noticing this. But apparently there's a series called Children of the Lamp, which revolves around some kids in the world of genies. And wouldn't you know it, there's a book behind Sakurai in the August 8th direct that looks sort of like a book from Children of the Lamp. Now, I tried to find some book covers that looked exactly like this, and I really couldn't. And it's really hard to compare them anyway because it's so blurry in the background. But the fact that it's this big yellow lettering and a blue background, and that's what a lot of the covers tend to look like, it really has me excited that this could be another hint. Super Mario Bros. Also pointed out that he saw a lamp on the shelf, and I looked at it, guys. I'm gonna mention it, but I really don't see it as a lamp. I really don't know what it is. Maybe it's just so blurry I can't see it, but I'm gonna mention it anyway because maybe some of you guys could ascertain that it's a lamp. It just looks like a metal blob to me. I know some people think it looks like a Mumbo token from Banjo and Kazooie. Who knows, man? Like, there's so many hints and teases we could pull from this one screenshot. It's crazy. Vexa Grimwoe pointed out that Shantae Half Genie Hero Ultimate Edition's box art looks very similar to that of Super Smash Bros. Wii U, and it also closely resembles Smash Ultimate's box art, so that could just be just like, hey, look at all the characters, but the fact that they look similar, it's interesting to note for sure. Sliced Flame, who like me has been doing a lot of Shantae speculation videos, pointed out just how expressive Shantae is in Half Genie Hero, and again, Sakurai pointed out specifically with Donkey Kong just how expressive all of the characters this time around are. So I think Shantae would have no problem fitting in with the cast, as expressive and as animated as she is. Now, I forgot to mention this when I talked about Kevin's post a minute ago, but he did note how the Alolan Executor Smash blog post featuring Bayonetta and Diddy Kong on Alolan Executor also hints more towards Shantae, because just like Shantae, Bayonetta can transform into animals, and I forgot to mention that in that video, but that is another good point to mention. A Young Spirit pointed out on his Twitter how Sakurai, in his Famitsu column, talks about giving different composers the freedom to compose music in their way and in their interpretation of it. And Big Feared Balloon had a very big, but very insightful comment. What's even crazier is the two characters on the side, Mega Man and Peach, have been mentioned in an article with Matt Bozon talking about Shantae for Smash, saying that he would want a style between these two characters. And if you really want to stretch it and speculate, the stage shown of Woohoo Island has landmarks that can be compared to Shantae, like the lighthouse, though this is easily a stretch and not something big to consider personally. Some more solid evidence is the fact that she was one of the best sellers for the DSiWare and Nintendo 3DS eShop. Many people also bring up history as well, which is a potential reason why Shovel Knight was beat out, who had only one game to his belt and is probably not getting a continuation with this series, with Yacht Club Games moving on from Shovel Knight. You could bring up the point that Shovel Knight got an amiibo, but apparently companies can actually make their own amiibo, and Matt Bozon did consider one for Shantae, but didn't. It's interesting to note how Matt turned down an amiibo for Shantae when he could have benefited from it. Like, why wouldn't they want an amiibo for Half Genie Hero, knowing it was probably coming to the Switch and it was going to be on the 3DS? So why would they do that? Could it be because she was in Smash and they didn't want to waste money on an amiibo and they already had one in the works? Only time will tell. And continuing on with the whole Shovel Knight amiibo thing, Pikachu Dory made a very interesting note about it. Something I found interesting is back in 2015, probably when Ultimate's roster was finalized, Shovel Knight got an amiibo. At first I thought this was random, but what if back then they already knew he was going to be an assist trophy, so he wasn't going to get an amiibo as a fighter, but they gave him an amiibo anyway, almost as if they wanted to show support to one of the two most iconic indie reps in some way. This seems like some honorable thing that Nintendo would do, because it wouldn't make sense to have two indie fighters, so whichever one didn't make it to the roster was still going to get some recognition, assist trophy, and amiibo. And Shovel Knight wasn't pushed as much as Shantae to be put in the game, but he still got in. At this point, if she doesn't make it on the roster, that'll be flat out disrespectful to WayForward, but like I said, Nintendo usually does honorable things. Pika, I love this comment because it's so cool that if Nintendo actually did this, like, of course this is just speculation, but if Nintendo actually did this and like gave Shovel Knight a consolation prize while Shantae got in and actually would have her own Smash amiibo, dude, that's so cool that they would do that for Yacht Club And just the fact that they would support Yacht Club and WayForward at the same time as two of the indie characters who were the most highly requested on the Smash ballot of all the characters, it's just, that'd be so cool on Nintendo's part. Tico Kira makes a really good point about Shantae being a Smash, especially in relation to Crystal from Star Fox. I don't know if anyone told you, but remember when everyone was saying Shantae's outfit is too mature or too lewd? Well, a month ago I was rewatching the Smash Direct, cause why not, and remembered Crystal from Star Fox, a character I wanted as well. The reason why it piqued my interest was her clothes. In Smash 4, her trophy had her in her battle suit. No skin, no fur, showing that was too lewd, right? But they chose this time to have her in her original design, which is basically a loincloth and a bra. That's a pretty lewd design, right? Why would they choose to have that design be showcased now, but didn't during Smash 4? I feel like it was to test the waters with Shantae's outfit. Shantae and Crystal both have the same top design, so if Crystal's design is allowed, then that automatically removes the her outfit keeps her from joining excuse, or maybe they just wanted to be nostalgic. And Tico left another comment. Ooh, one more thing I just thought of. WayForward, as we know, have been silent, right? We know this, but another sign she is in Smash, DLC base or assist trophy, is WayForward has not debunked any of our theories. Game developers have come out and said when fans were wrong about a character being featured somewhere or misleading information. For instance, the Dante one. The producer of Dante was one of the few to say, no, Dante isn't in. Then again, my friend says he's known for trolling fans, so take that with a grain of salt. So basically, because WayForward isn't saying we are wrong or debunking our theories, I believe Shantae has made my boys. Very interesting point, and of course Omni talked about this in his comment where, you know, WayForward could just be doing this to, you know, get hype for Shantae and, you know, get her recognition not only in the Smash community, but in the gaming community. So I don't think WayForward would do something that underhanded, but I do think their silence says something about, you know, her being in the game in some way, shape, or form. Going back to the what I call the Shantae and Daisy butt bump theory for the Everyone Is Here banner, Elam Omni Alpha pointed out that Daisy and Shantae marked the beginning and the end of the Game Boy. Super Mario Land was the system's launch title, and Shantae was the final game to close the system out. It only adds a deeper connection to these two ladies interacting on the banner. Trevor McDermott left a really interesting comment as well. Here's something I've been holding on to, hoping more people would see it. It may or may not have something to do with Shantae, but it's pretty interesting nonetheless. Two Button Crew met the former WayForward CEO on vacation. At the 5-minute mark, he meets with Tim and they talk. Later, a collaboration is mentioned. It may be about Shantae. And I actually did watch this video, and I'll provide a link to that Two Button Crew video he's talking about. But it is interesting that even the former CEO knew about some kind of big crossover event, and I'm hoping that it's Shantae and Smash. Julio TM Maker on Twitter had DM'd me some very interesting things about Shantae for Smash. I have some logical thoughts that may seem very interesting. When Shantae had that little new challenger reference, wouldn't it make more sense for her to be a playable character rather than an assist trophy? What would be more memorable that Sakurai would do? First playable indie as a base or DLC? Another thought. And even if Shantae's voice actress was doing it for a new Shantae game, Sakurai would have included her in Smash to get Shantae more recognition for the new Shantae game. Very good points, Julio. Thank you for sharing, dude. And finally, we close it out with a young spirit's reply to Artsy Omni. This line of thought is not entirely sound. Again, organic marketing works better when you're a big company who can already generate strong buzz, and it only garners short-term results. A small company like WayForward risks frustrating its core audience, on which it relies upon greatly for word of mouth. Besides, why go as far back as late 2015 to start this tactic when there was no Smash discussion anymore about her, and they should have gained simply by encouraging fans showing their support? Why does it apply so strictly to every person in production, directing, designing, acting, music, etc., who did not even congratulate Shovel Knight's developers when the assist trophy was revealed, whereas they did it for their previous accomplishments because they used to be one and the same company? The Minecraft social reps have gone this way recently, at Minecon, stating that if fans wished for Steve's presence in Smash, they should make it known. It works a lot better in this instance because they do not dissipate the anticipation, and they do not snob the asking party. Young makes a great point about how WayForward depends on its core fan base to draw new fans in. So why would you anger the fans that are giving you so much credibility to start with, that voted for Shantae in the ballot? Why would you sit there and pretty much insult them by teasing this much, by doing all this stuff, being so silent, and then she's not playable? It's very sneaky and underhanded, and I don't see WayForward doing that. Maybe I'm just being too optimistic about it, because at the end of the day, WayForward is still a company, and companies have to make money. But I can't help but think that as deeply intertwined as WayForward is with their fan base, I can't see them doing something like this to them. So with all that said, this is all the information and all the speculation about Shantae in Smash coming to a close. It's been one heck of a ride, and I just thank you guys so much for just sharing so much and allowing me to make a part four to this, because I was done. Like, part three was it. And you guys just, you chimed in so much, and I have to thank you guys, because I wanted this to be a tribute to the fan base, because you guys have poured so much into my videos. You guys have done so much to support my channel. My subscriber count has literally doubled because of the Shantae fan base, and I'm just still in awe of your support. I'm still so proud to be a part of this community now, and it's just, I know I'm hyped, and I know you guys are hyped. And, like, I want to damper my expectations, but at the same time, I can't, because there's so much pointing to her getting in Smash. Maybe I am just being optimistic. Maybe I'm just some crazy dude that's just like, yeah, Shantae's gonna be in Smash because the fans want her. But at the same time, you look at characters like King K. Rool, and Ridley, and Inkling, and Daisy, and Crom, who were highly requested, and have been highly requested from fans for a long, long time, and Sakurai is listening, and he's adding these characters, and I don't doubt that characters like Bandana Waddle Dee, Geno, Isaac, Banjo-Kazooie, Sora, and other characters that people want are gonna be added either as DLC or base roster. Sakurai is doing fan service right this game, and I can't help but think that Shantae is one of those fan service picks as our first indie rep, as a Smash ballot pick, and as just a great character that the fans want. So thank you guys so much for watching. Thank you guys so much for contributing to this video. And if you guys enjoyed it, as always, hit that like button, subscribe to join the pack if you're new and you enjoy my content. And I'm sure some of you are thinking, well, now that you're done with Shantae, what's left for the channel? Well, there is a certain spiky-haired Square Enix character I still have to talk about. And there's also a Spartan Super Soldier that I want to talk about as well. So again, thank you guys so much for your support. It's been a crazy ride. Of course, there's rumors going around of a Smash Direct, and I can't wait to see it come to fruition, because that might be the time we finally get Shantae in Smash. And though I have doubted Shantae some because of the naysayers and the haters and all the people saying she has no chance, she'll never get in, I look back at this evidence, and I look at the support you guys have given her since the Smash ballot, and I can't help but think she's in this game, and I'm not giving up that hope. I'm not giving up that dream, and I'm not giving up until Ultimate comes to a close, because whether she gets in the roster as base or DLC, I still think Shantae is going to be playable in Super Smash Bros. Ultimate. So as always, until next time, guys, God bless, and thanks for watching.